human beings have an innate desire, this insatiable drive to understand the world around us, to know that which is outside our reach, to make sense of the unknowable. We want to know everything, but cannot even begin to fathom what everything even is. These incomprehensible aspects of the universe, of the reality we inhabit, are well outside the horizons of rational thought. But, as you may well know, the human mind is not merely rational. That step beyond rational thinking that needs to be taken to fully grapple with some of these ideas is where we enter the purview of mysticism.
Mysticism is seen to be a highly specialized form of that search for reality, for heightened and completed life, which we've found to be a constant characteristic of human consciousness. It is largely prosecuted by that spiritual spark, that transcendental faculty which, though the life of our life, remains below the threshold in ordinary men. Emerging from its hiddenness in the mystic, it gradually becomes the dominant factor in his life, subduing to its service and enhancing by its saving contact with reality those vital powers of love and will which we attribute to the heart, rather than those of mere reason and perception which we attribute to the head.
For our examination, we'll be looking at Evelyn Underhill's 1911 book, Mysticism, A Study in Nature and Development of Spiritual Consciousness, in which she provides an overview of mystic practice and explores the conscious development of those who follow the mystic path. Mysticism is one of those words whose meaning in common usage has gotten bastardized over time. Like the word theory, it's a term that refers to a very particular idea within its field of study, which tends not to match the way it's used in common speech. As Underhill says in her preface to the first edition,
"Mysticism is one of the most abused words in the English language. It has been used in different and often mutually exclusive senses by religion, poetry, and philosophy, has been claimed as an excuse for every kind of occultism, for dilute transcendentalism, vapid symbolism, religious or aesthetic sentimentality, and bad metaphysics. On the other hand, it has been freely employed as a term of contempt by those who have criticized these things. It is much to be hoped that it may be restored sooner or later to its old meaning as the science or art of the spiritual life."
Put simply, mysticism is a family of spiritual practices that lead to altered states of the practitioner's psyche, where occult practices, with which mysticism is often conflated, typically seek to alter the external world in some way. The mystic seeks to internally alter their experience of the world around them. Everything is a 2017 game that's known for having animals that roll around instead of walking. Hold on. Everything is a 2017 game where the player inhabits the form of various objects and entities in the known universe, ranging from life on Earth to atoms and molecules to planets and galaxies to fundamental forces of reality and abstract shapes, which is typically framed as being everything, just not all at once. This is all contextualized by the audio clips that play throughout the game of lectures given by Alan Watts, notable author and public speaker who promoted Hindu, Buddhist, and Taoist ideas to Anglophone audiences.
See, every one of you feels that you're the center of the universe, and that everything else is happening around you in a circle. You can turn around and you can see sort of equally far in all directions, especially if you're in a ship in the middle of the ocean. So you're in the middle. And it's true from the standpoint of astronomy. We live in a curved space-time continuum, that is to say, in a universe at which every point may be regarded as the center. Consider a sphere. Here's a ball. What point on this ball is the center of its surface? You can see at once that any point can be the center of its surface. So legitimately, all points in the universe are the center.
The lecture clips that are included in the game are mostly about the idea of the self, or more specifically, the illusion of self. Of course, this naturally asks the player to consider those ideas at face value. What is selfhood? Where do the boundaries of selfhood lie? And why do we think of ourselves as separate from everything else? Since the mechanic the game's designed around is one of inhabiting the form of various objects in the universe, these lectures about selfhood also ask the player to consider the selfhood of the game avatar, the object whose movement and behavior is directly influenced by player input. You, as the player, don't exist as this entity moving before you on the screen, and yet you exert control over its actions. You are divorced from, and yet still an integral part of, its existence.
Mysticism is non-individualistic. It implies, indeed, the abolition of individuality, of that hard separateness, that I, me, mine, which makes of man a finite, isolated thing. It is, essentially, a movement of the heart, seeking to transcend the limitations of the individual standpoint and to surrender itself to ultimate reality. For no personal gain, to satisfy no transcendental curiosity, to obtain no otherworldly joys, but purely from an instinct of love.
The form of that avatar is continuously changing, but its movement and actions remain the same across all the myriad things. They're distinctly human actions. Buildings don't go for a stroll around the block, but moving freely through their environment is something buildings do here because it's something everything else does too. Mostly, I think that's a product of how the game is engaging with the content of Watts's lectures. He makes a lot of these essentialist moves that pose other living beings as relating to the world in the same way humans do, which aren't great, and there's a lot of unpacking we could do there, but with that criticism in mind, we can still pigeonhole this into our broader reading. The humor of some of these situations calls attention to the fact that the experience of being something is more than inhabiting a particular shape and interacting with the environment in a particular way. It also points out our limitation, that we cannot know the experience of being another thing. Even if we do manage to step outside a sense of selfhood, we're still limited by a human perspective. I don't know what it's like to be a piece of poop flopping around on the sidewalk. On the other hand, having the same set of mechanics plays into the idea that all things are born of the same source. Different forms that the universe takes, even after changing shape, it's still the same thing that moves and behaves the same way. Whenever the avatar takes on another form, it's not a singular object changing shape. The state of game control and mechanical focus is transferred between objects. So different objects become the avatar as it moves between things. It's natural to read the interactive tie to a particular object as representing consciousness. This is the being through which our perception and action are being filtered, but when that consciousness moves from one entity to another, it's taking its experience with it. It's hard to read that transfer as leaving one consciousness behind to enter and see through another, since we, as the player, still have a continuous experience that flows through all those transfers.
All activities of the self are grouped about a center of consciousness whose correspondences are with the material world. In the moment of its awakening, it is abruptly made aware of this disability. It knows itself finite. It now aspires to the infinite. It is encased in mysticism, the hard crust of individuality. It aspires to a union with a larger self. It is fettered. It longs for freedom. Its every sense is attuned to illusion. It craves for harmony with the absolute truth.
When we talk about the absolute or the divine or especially God as it relates to mysticism, there's a certain limitation we run into when using English to talk about it. And that's because of how heavily the English language has been influenced by Christian hegemony. The divine that mystics come to know in unitive experience is not necessarily theistic, nor even an entity, at least not one that exists in the world, but the words used to talk about such an experience connote the same sort of personified existence of a divine being. While this is a fairly typical understanding of such a description, it doesn't always match the experience being described by mystics, especially in non-theistic religious traditions. Watts hardly refers to God in the game's audio clips, but one could say what he's talking about is God in the same way I refer to God throughout this essay and even in my outside life.
What I would call a kind of a basic problem we've got to go through first is to understand that there are no such things as things. That is to say, separate things. That is only a way of talking. And if you can understand this, you're going to have no further problems. I once asked a group of high school children, what do you mean by a thing? And first of all, they gave me all sorts of synonyms. They said, it's an object, which is simply another word for a thing. It doesn't tell you anything about what you mean by a thing. And finally, a very smart girl who was in the group said, a thing is a noun. And she was quite right. A noun isn't a part of nature, it's a part of speech. There are no nouns in the physical world. There are no separate things in the physical world either. See, the physical world is wiggly. The clouds, mountains, trees, people are all wiggly. And only when human beings get working at things, they build buildings in straight lines and try and make out that the world isn't really wiggly. But here are we sitting in this room, all built on straight lines, but each one of us is as wiggly as all get out.
There are two broad categories of mystic practices, cataphatic and apophatic. In cataphatic theology, God is known through affirmation, descriptions of what God is, which the mystic builds to God is everything. Apophatic theology, on the other hand, knows God through negation. We can only say what God is not, which pares down the universe to ultimately leave us with, there is nothing but God. I think it's fairly apparent which of the two approaches this game takes. If we ask ourselves, what does God or the divine look like in this game, we're not left with much of an answer. There are no game objects that represent God. There is no formal element in the game's code that represents some theistic presence that we can point to and say, aha, that's it. The closest thing we see is the ball of light that the game starts us with, and we see again at the end of the tutorial, but it's hard to see it as being anything but another object that exists alongside all the other objects, despite not being named in the catalog of things. We could read it as some seed of consciousness through which the game world is being experienced, along the theological lines of the universe observing itself. But since it's framed as having conscious thought, it reads to me more like the same kind of consciousness that each of us as individuals exist with. Maybe a part of God closer than the cataloged things, but not itself God. The achievement descriptions for the game refer to everything as a singular entity taking some action. For example, everything sings to itself, which is a prompt to sing some number of times. Even though the player only inhabits a subset of objects in existence at any given time, the achievements suggest that no matter what, the player inhabits everything all at once, even if it's only recognizable as a singular object. This conveys a sort of panentheism, where the divine exists outside the universe and intertwines everything of the universe, for example, being contained within or as a manifestation of God. The game world, as it exists in the abstract, is mediated by physical hardware operations. So we could say as well, following this reading of panentheism, that God is the hardware that runs the game. This is kind of a stretch, but there is a key moment in the game that suggests this reading. At the end of the player's descent into the Golden Gate, a computer monitor appears that displays the contents of the in-game camera. It directly calls attention to the relationship between the in-game world and its existence in our physical reality. This monitor is representative of that physical hardware, but exists within that hardware. Recursively, even, since that monitor itself shows another monitor that it's simulating. The next monitor does in turn, and so on. Another read along the thread of panentheism, since the player is prompted by Watts's lectures to consider their relationship of self with the game, is that it frames the player external to the game as the entity of God within the software's code. The paradox here, of course, is that the player does not exist within the written code, but the reason I like this reading is that it's metaphoric to a fairly typical way that mystics understand the relationship between reality and the divine. It lies beyond the context of that which is real, yet paradoxically can still be known in some way. In her book, Underhill outlines four characteristics of mysticism, the first of which, we'll come back to the others later, the first of which is that it's not a theoretical endeavor. It is a process of internal transformation. We can wax philosophically all day long about what God is and our relationship to it, but to know God, as the mystic knows God, entails a change at the fundamental core of one's being.
Mysticism, then, is not an opinion. It's not a philosophy. It has nothing in common with the pursuit of occult knowledge. On the one hand, it is not merely the power of contemplating eternity. On the other, it is not to be identified with any kind of religious queerness. It is the name of that organic process which involves the perfect consummation of the love of God, the achievement here and now of the immortal heritage of man. Or, if you like it better, for this means exactly the same thing, it is the art of establishing his conscious relation with the absolute.
I've known quite a few people in my life to hold ideas taught by mystic traditions without themselves undergoing the practice of mysticism. It's as easy as listening to one of Watts's lectures to conceptualize the interconnectedness of the universe, but even after consciously accepting the idea that there is no individual self, the way they experience the world is still filtered through a perception of existing within their body. The practice of mysticism, well, it changes that a little bit. Typically, throughout waking life, there is a distinct sense, if you start to pay attention to it, that I exist. I am here. That my thoughts and my body are a part of me. And that the other things are other things. This shirt that I'm wearing, while I've attached it to myself, is not a part of me, even if you say, of course, Watts is right. How silly that I would think of myself as separate from everything else. That sense of selfness is still really hard to shake. If you do manage to step away from yourself, what does that actually look like? How does your lived experience change? The things that we typically think of as being part of ourselves start to feel separate. The body starts to feel like another part of the environment, and its movement isn't being directed by you so much as it moves on its own while the mind watches. From there, the senses and even thoughts start to follow the same route. And how do we get this to happen? I guess you could try rolling on the ground for a bit.
If you will accept the idea that you are your own eyes and your own heart and your own ears with that wonderful spiral cochlea inside and all these amazing gadgets here, you're all that. Now, therefore, by a little extension of the imagination, you can very well see that if all those subtleties inside you feel other than your conscious ego, but nevertheless are one with it, the same argument will go for all the other things going on around you. The sun shining, the stars twinkling, the wind blowing, and the great ocean restlessly pounding against these cliffs. That's you too. You don't control it, of course, because there has to be something about you you don't control, or you wouldn't be you. Because to understand the principle of relativity is there's no self without other.
There's actually a really good metaphor for this in the game. When we set down the controller, the game begins to play itself. The avatar moves without input from the player, but the camera is still attached to it. Even though there's still a sense of following a particular game object, there's an aesthetic distance that's built up between the player and avatar. Even though this is the avatar through which you've been interacting with the game, it's not a part of you. And watching it move itself feels, in some ways, similar to the mystic's sense of watching their body. Looking at the changes that practitioners undergo in the mystic process, Underhill outlines 5 stages she observed that were common to accounts of well-known mystics: awakening, purgation, illumination, surrender or a dark night of the soul, and unification. They aren't universal to the mystic process so much as they are general. And there's a lot of variance in what the stages actually look like between people. Overall, it's useful to look at this for a sense of how the mind changes throughout the process. Everything actually gives us a rough progression through these 5 stages, but like the experience of them, it's not really clear-cut. We don't see a separate level for each stage of progression.
This awakening, from the psychological point of view, appears to be an intense form of the phenomenon of conversion, and closely akin to those deep and permanent conversions of the adult type, which some religious psychologists call sanctification. It is a disturbance of the equilibrium of the self, which results in the shifting of the field of consciousness from lower to higher levels, with a consequent removal of the center of interest from the subject to an object now brought into view, the necessary beginning of any process of transcendence.
Awakening is easy to misinterpret as being a conscious revelation, where you learn something new and it changes your ideological stance. But as we talked about, it's not as simple as changing the ideas in your head. There is a distinct change to your mental faculties. The mystic sees and knows the world differently, and awakening is their first taste of that change. When I was in high school, I was walking between classes one day when suddenly my sense of reality was different. It felt like I was seeing the reality around me more deeply and with more clarity than I had previously, even though nothing about my sensory experience had changed. My legs continued to walk, but they didn't feel like a part of my conception of self, merely legs attached to me that were now moving of their own accord rather than my typical will for myself to move. The whole thing made me wonder, what is reality? It kind of freaked me out, but when I had snapped out, I realized it was really cool, and I wanted to know what was happening and how to make it happen again. If I could see reality differently, see it more deeply, then surely I was just scratching the surface.
All conversion entails the abrupt or gradual emergence of intuitions from below the threshold, the consequent remaking of the field of consciousness, an alteration in the self's attitude toward the world. For the mystic, it means the first emergence of that passion for the absolute, which is to constitute his distinctive character, an emergence crucial in its effect on every department of his life.
The game opens with a ball of light floating through the void. It thinks a few existential questions, and then an animal materializes around the light. We're placed into the animal's environment with a weird golden structure positioned in front of us. There's a low-hanging reading of this, which, of course, is that the ball of light is waking up to the reality of existence. But we have to keep in mind how this is being framed. We have no idea what this ball of light is or what it's supposed to represent, how it relates to the animal that's now before us, or what the fuck we're supposed to make of the giant golden caltrop sitting on the ground. That's all the carrot on a stick. The process of seeking has begun. There's a sense that these things are transcendent in some way. This framing, after all, comes from the questions the ball of light asks, but we have no idea how or why, or even what to do with that. But we want to. And it's going to be sticking in the back of our mind until we find out.
All the twisted elements of character which foster the existence of this unreal yet complex creature are to be pruned away. Then, as with the trees of the forest, so with the spirit of man, strong new branches will spring into being, grow towards air and light. "I live, yet not I," is to be the declaration of the mystic who has endured this bodily death. The self that is to be will live upon a plane where her own prejudices and preferences are so uninteresting as to be imperceptible. She must be weaned from these nursery toys, and weaning is a disagreeable process. The mystic, however, undertakes it as a rule without reluctance, pushed by his vivid consciousness of imperfection, his intuition of a more perfect state, necessary to the fulfillment of his love.
Purgation, or the purgation of self, is maybe a lot more obvious when I say the full title. It's where the mystic begins to purge the sense of self. This is, for example, where that sense of separateness from the body comes into full effect. This arm that moves doesn't move because I move it. It moves as a rock skipping across a pond, because something else has acted upon it in a way that makes it move. But this sensation doesn't stop at the body. There can be the same detachment from thoughts as well, just as there is a consciousness that perceives and watches the body it's stuck to, moving itself. It watches the thoughts attached to it think themselves as well. It's uncomfortable, of course. Psychologically, our brains are wired to hold on to that ego because it's useful from a standpoint of survival, so changing that wiring is a bit tricky. I had been lucky enough when I was an undergrad to be able to work with a mentor who could guide me on that mystic path I'd unwittingly found myself walking. One of the meditation exercises Connie would have her students do was weeding her rose garden. Eager to help someone as old as she was by the time I was studying with her, I volunteered every few weeks. And something she said to me every time I arrived was, "Pull the weeds until you become the weed." Part of the exercise, of course, is thinking through what the fuck that even means, but as I continued, I began to feel the entire plant just from where I'd placed my hands, as though it had become a part of me, and when the roots let go of their grip on the soil, it felt like a part of my soul was being pulled as well. By the time I'd finished pulling all the weeds in her rose garden, I didn't have any sense of connection with my physical body. It was just moving on its own while I watched. The more I indulged in this exercise, the more it felt like the thoughts that were being thunk in my own mind were just there. The center of my consciousness would shrink to mere distilled perception.
Primarily then, the self must be purged of all that stands between it and goodness, putting on the character of reality instead of the character of illusion or sin. It longs ardently to do this from the first moment in which it sees itself in the all-revealing radiance of the uncreated light.
Once we start moving around and interacting with the world, we have new mechanics introduced to us. Singing and dancing give a direct mode of interaction with other things in the environment and offer a socialized connection to things singing back at you. Joining other animals into a herd shifts attention from the individual to the group. The camera pans back to frame the avatar as the group instead of an individual in the group. And when animals leave, the previous avatar may be one that exits the group. If we go back down to an individual animal, our avatar may not be the same one that started growing the herd. Once we get the ability to ascend and descend, we stop identifying our play with a particular avatar. But there is still an avatar our play is attached to, and when we set down the controller, that builds aesthetic distance between us and the avatar.
In illumination, we come to that state of consciousness which is popularly supposed to be peculiar to the mystic, a form of mental life, a kind of perception radically different from that of normal men. His preceding adventures and experiences cannot be allowed this quality. His awakening to consciousness of the absolute, though often marked by a splendor and intensity which seem to distinguish it from other psychic upheavals of that kind, does but reproduce upon higher levels those characteristic processes of conversion and falling in love, which give depth and actuality to the religious and passional life.
We arrive at illumination once the changes experienced in purgation become a regular part of waking life, once they start to become a part of our being. One of the markers that separates illumination from purgation is that there is a deep sense of love that fills the gaps from what we've purged. So what we see in this stage is that profound love permeating every part of the conscious mind. It's worth noting, though, that the state of awareness that we know before awakening doesn't get replaced here. The states of mind I'm describing come and go, but with various frequency, intensity, and valence at different stages. In Sufism, the metaphor that's used is diving for pearls. Just as we can only hold our breath for so long, the mind can't sustain that kind of altered state forever. In most of my own waking life, I do still feel a connection to my body and thoughts, the same as if I had never been a mystic in the first place, but I often have moments where I find myself overwhelmed by the beauty of existence in every minutia of detail and things that I can see and hear and sense, and overwhelmed by the love for all that beauty and for the people and things that surround me. I haven't taken any mind-altering substances recreationally other than alcohol, but some of the mystic experiences I've had are pretty similar to what I imagine some low-dosage drug trips might be like. The most powerful of these illuminative experiences I've had came when I was living on the road, the year before the pandemic, a big extended road trip. And one of the stops I had planned on making from the outset of the trip was to visit the mentor I mentioned earlier, who had since retired and moved to Florida. Connie was one of the most influential people in my life. She was a spiritual teacher and guide to me and countless other students, and I wouldn't have the expertise in mysticism that I do, intellectually or in practice, if I hadn't had the chance to work with her. She passed away about 4 months before I had planned to visit. I still paid a visit to her husband when I was passing through the area, and at some point I was sitting alone on the couch looking around at the decorations. Connie's home decor was very distinctive and vibrant. I broke down crying, and while I was crying, I heard shouts of laughter from kids playing in a neighboring yard and thought about how beautiful that moment was. The liveliness and unadulterated joy of the children laughing and the vibrancy of Connie's favorite artworks. It was exactly how she would have wanted to be commemorated. For whatever reason, I decided I should go take a shower. I stepped in just bawling at this point, but with a huge grin on my face. I remember holding my hands out to feel the shower water on my palms, and I kept looking at them and thinking, how amazing is it that I have hands? I looked over at the deep blue shower curtain to my left, and the intensity of the color pierced all of my senses. I reached out to touch it, and as I rubbed against the vinyl, I felt the entire universe wiping against my skin. By this point, I had gone from grinning to laughing hysterically at the sheer absurdity, but still sobbing uncontrollably. I wasn't alternating between the two, they were simultaneous. And I saw a black cloud moving into the shower from over the curtain. Not like I hallucinated it, but I had the vibes of seeing a black cloud. The thought that was underpinning all of this was how amazing it is that I can have loved someone, can still feel so much love after she's gone, that her absence caused that much pain. The whole episode wasn't fueled by pain, that was a main ingredient in the emotional cocktail, but it was driven by how much love I felt.
That serene and illuminated consciousness of the relation of things inward and outward is, at its best, a state of fine equilibrium, a sane adjustment of the inner and outer life. By that synthesis of love and will, which is the secret of the heart, the mystic achieves a level of perception in which the whole world is seen and known in God, and God is seen and known in the whole world. It is a state of exalted emotion. Being produced by love, of necessity, it produces love in its turn.
For a while, after unlocking most of the core mechanics of the game, there's a period of wandering aimlessly throughout the environments. When playing through it myself, there wasn't a sense of boredom despite the repetitiveness. It felt more like a flow state. Chill vibes. Like tracing my finger through a small container of sand to see what patterns arise. At this point, the audio clips from Watts are frequently playing in the background. More chill vibes. I don't think this section of the game does that well to convey the intensity of illumination. The biggest moments in this section are when we see the message that the Golden Gate had opened, and again, once we find our way back to it. But what it does get is illumination's relationship to the other stages. Once we've gone far enough into purgation, or here, been given enough of the mechanics, that state of being becomes us and becomes a default mode of engaging with the world, rather than a trance state we slip in and out of. To find our way back to the Golden Gate, we have to set down the controller and let the game play itself until we naturally arrive back where we began.
The Dark Knight is a complete emotional lassitude. The disappearance of all the old ardors, now replaced by a callousness, a boredom, which the self detests but cannot overcome. It is the dismal condition of spiritual ennui, which ascetic writers know so well under the name of aridity, and which psychologists look upon as the result of emotional fatigue. It seems incredible that the eager love of a divine companion, so long the focus of the self's whole being, should have vanished. That not only the transcendent vision should be withdrawn, but her very desire for and interest in that vision should grow cold, Yet the mystics are unanimous in declaring that this is a necessary stage in the growth of the spiritual consciousness.
The Dark Night of the Soul, named for a well-known poem by St. John of the Cross about this stage in his mystic journey, is where the psychic pendulum swings in the opposite direction. The highs of mysticism are seen in illumination, and the lows are found in the dark night. In illumination, we have purged enough of the self to see God, to commune with the divine, but we still know it as separate from ourself. To truly achieve divine union, the self has to be weeded out at the root. Like we saw with illumination, it's not often a sustained state of mind. It comes and goes, but when it hits, it can be pretty intense. The impression I get also is that the Dark Night probably has the most variation among parts of the mystic path, but the big thing all the variations have in common is that they fucking suck! René Descartes famously exclaimed, "I think, therefore I am," after spending days systematically doubting everything he could possibly doubt, until he arrived at the conclusion that he could not doubt that he was thinking. To which the mystic in this stage might reply, "Bet, but what if I did though?" Which is why I don't feel like I exist right now. When I started outlining ideas for this video, I wondered how I was going to talk about the Dark Night as a stage I hadn't gone through yet myself. Then, shortly after I started writing, it hit me. What convenient timing for an existential crisis! It started from thinking about mortality. Go figure, during a global pandemic, but I think it was mostly coincidental timing. Suddenly, the idea of death started putting this dense, squeezing knot in my gut, exactly what I imagine I'd be feeling if I were told I was going to die soon. I stared mortality in the face because I could feel it staring into me. My mind was trying to wrap itself around the idea of not existing anymore, a yeet into the void. And that's tough because I have no concept for what it's like to not exist. I only have knowledge of having existed. The closest frame of reference we have is being asleep, and the whole thing about being unconscious is that we're not conscious of it. What's better for stomping out a sense of self than facing the fact that I will necessarily stop existing one day? I am ephemeral. I will no longer be I, the material pieces that construct everything I think of as I will still exist, but there will cease to be an I that thinks and perceives attached to those physical objects. None of these are new ideas or perspectives for me. It's all the same stuff I was thinking a decade ago, but the way I'm processing it is different now in a way that's more visceral. The biggest change is that it feels like the threads of reality have dissolved around me. I mentioned earlier that for most people there is a sense of presence in the world if you stop and pay attention to it, and I don't have that right now. Staring into the void has caused the reality around me, including the reality of me, to feel like it's sunken into that void. And now I know what you're probably thinking, but Cyril, that just sounds like depression. Yes, it's been a lot like depression.
It is clear that so drastic a process of unselfing is not likely to take place without stress. It is the negative aspect of deification, in which the self, deprived of perception, knowledge, will, work, self-seeking, the I, the me, the mine, loses itself, denies itself, unforms itself, drawing ever nearer to the one, till nothing is to be seen but a ground which rests upon itself, the ground of the soul, in which it has union with God.
The emotional qualia of the Dark Night as I've experienced it have been about the same as when I've gone through depressive episodes. I had the same lack of motivation and a deeper sense of meaninglessness, but I didn't try to turn away from it, like I have when dealing with mental illness. As soon as I felt that pit in my stomach, I knew there was something different about this that I wanted to face head on, because I could tell it was going to lead to growth when I came out the other side. It is worth mentioning that there is a surprising amount of apparent overlap between some aspects of mystic experience and mental illness. The Dark Knight is often compared to depression, and the feeling of watching yourself that pervades most mystic experiences awfully similar to dissociation, which is a common trauma response. I am not a mental health expert and do not have the expertise to offer any kind of insights into their relationship, but it seems to me, again, not a mental health expert, that what we're looking at here are moments of growth, which tend to draw us into them in a way that mental illness does not. If you're feeling something that seems like a problem, it's probably worth consulting a mental health professional.
What is this that I call I? That's one of the very fascinating questions. It teases us out of thought to think about death in the sense of going to sleep and never waking up. Imagine that. And you find you can't, and yet it's a thought that, although you can't get to grips with it, it remains fascinating. Also the question, how is it suddenly that you awakened into this world? Where were you before? And that's the same sort of weird question as what it would be like to go to sleep and never wake up. What was it like to wake up having not previously gone to sleep? It's very mysterious.
Descending into the Golden Gate marks the onset of the Dark Knight, and it is intentional about the use of descent to enter. The space we find ourselves in is divorced from the space we were previously occupying, with no discernible connection between the two. Neither the landscape nor collection of surrounding objects convey a recognizable environment. We're not only lost, but have maybe fallen out of existence. There's a sense of being trapped here, too. When we try to ascend and move back to a space we're comfortable in, we're told that we can't leave. You're stuck here forever. There is no escape. And the thoughts of surrounding objects convey anguish and powerlessness. The way to get out is the same way we came in, by setting down the controller and letting the game take us to where we need to be. That makes a mechanical connection between the Dark Knight and Illumination, showing us that they're two parts of the same psychic oscillation. A lot of mystic traditions focus on the idea of surrender, and it's at this point that the idea of moving through by surrendering yourself to God or the universe becomes apparent in our reading. In exactly the same way, I had to step into the void before I could step through it. Once we're able to ascend back out of the Golden Gate, we see a cutscene where the ball of light rises out of the gate. The camera follows it as it flies around different environments, which indicates that it has been part of the game avatar the whole time, but no longer tethered to any other game objects.
The wheel of life has made its circle. Here, at the last point of its revolution, the extremes of sublimity and simplicity are seen to meet. It has swept the soul of the mystic through periods of alternate stress and glory, tending ever to greater transcendence, greater freedom, closer contact with the supplier of true life. In that mysterious death of selfhood on the summit, which is the medium of eternal life, heights meet the deeps. Supreme achievement and complete humility are one.
In unification, the mystic has achieved oneness with the divine, the object of their journey. It doesn't carry the same ecstasy as illumination, nor miseries of the dark night, but the oscillation between the two has reached equilibrium and the soul's pendulum has come to a stop. I don't know what this stage looks like, and I don't know if I ever will. I necessarily have less insight here than I do onto other parts of the journey because I haven't seen it. The one thing that's apparent to me from Underhill's writing and the accounts she shares is that this is where we arrive at once we have completely lost all sense of self. After leaving the Golden Gate, the ball of light flies around various environments. By the end of its flight, we see various completely unrelated objects spinning and moving around each other in circular patterns. And it drops back into the animal we started with at the location where we started. We're given a congratulatory message for completing the tutorial. It does a lot here with connecting the ending to the beginning. First, of course, is being returned to the starting place after completing the journey, recognizing it anew. And second, in congratulating us for completing the tutorial, which typically marks the beginning of a game after a cutscene that reads very much as an ending. By doing this, it ties the two together, remarking that the end is merely the beginning of the game, yet the beginning is a natural end for most players.
The simplest expression of the unitive life, the simplest interpretation which we can put on its declarations, is that it is the complete and conscious fulfillment, here and now, of this perfect love.
Something that Underhill consistently reiterates throughout her book is that mystics typically are practical people. But what's so practical about this pursuit of divinity? What's the point of achieving oneness with the universe or wrapping your being with some beatific holy love? That sense of oneness isn't an abstract idea. As we saw in the first of Underhill's four characteristics of mysticism, it's a tangible sensation. The other characteristics are that it's an entirely spiritual pursuit, that the active pursuits of the mystic way imprint definite changes upon our psyche, and I think most importantly, that the method and motivation of mysticism are love. As much as it's an internal practice of contemplation, introspection, and self-sacrifice, it's just as much an external practice of love and empathy. It reminds us that we are not alone as individuals and that we have a duty to those around us. Whatever the outcome of practice, the world around us continues to exist and we continue to exist in the world. The old man meditating atop a mountain must at some point come down off of the mountain to return home, and I still have to remember to empty my dishwasher when I get home.
Though the end of mysticism is not adequately defined as goodness, it entails the acquirement of goodness. The virtues are the ornaments of the spiritual marriage, because that marriage is a union with the good, no less than with the beautiful and the true.
I find myself so drawn to mysticism, not merely due to an insatiable curiosity, but primarily from a deep, growing well of love at my core that wants to flow out into the world. It's easy to undervalue the strive for goodness. When it comes to the outcomes of those qualities of goodness and compassion, it's just as important to have the critical skills to discern what actions are going to be of material benefit. But we cannot overlook the importance of that desire for goodness, to be more compassionate. Everything else follows from there.